Good afternoon. Or should I say evening? Morning. Morning? At any rate, I am the Game Master. Pleased to make your acquaintance. Before we begin, there is something I must tell you. You see, my job is to draw you into this world with my voice and cards, which is why I believe it best for you to play with the sound on. In fact, I insist on it. However, as you can see, my voice is subtitled, so you can always read along as well. Now then, are you ready? Let's begin. Welcome to Voice of Cards. You are about to take the first steps of your adventure. Through a realm of sword and sorcery you will travel, battling bloodthirsty monsters as you strive to realize your ambitions. I have every faith you will accomplish great things here. I am merely a witness to your exploits. Now then, your departure draws nigh. May your journey be a safe one. This is Castle Advent. Queen Nilla reigns over the kingdom from within its walls. Three white-clad adventurers have gathered here at the Queen's summons. Present yourselves, O faithful of the Ivory Order. From upon her throne, the Queen regards the adventurers. So you are disciples of the Order. The youngest of the three steps forward. She holds herself with well-born grace. I am Winifred of the Ivory Order, Your Majesty, she says. I lead this fellowship. She bows, glancing to her two companions. In response, the stern-looking one inclines his head and brusquely names himself Berwin. The older man is the picture of courtesy, as he genuflects and introduces himself as Hedwin. It is these three our story follows today. In other words, your party. The Queen acknowledges the fellowship with a nod. In a soft voice, she explains her errand. Someone has stolen the royal treasure. I bid you reclaim it. Under normal circumstances, I would entrust this to my soldiers, but I do not wish to spread thin my forces with the recent monster troubles. It seems the troubled queen has judged she can entrust this matter to none but the Ivory Order, beloved of the people and unmatchable in battle. It is our honor to serve you, Your Majesty, and thus the quest falls to the Fellowship. Short of any clues that could lead them to the culprit, however, they pressed the Queen for further information. The Fellowship asks the Queen if she knows anything about the thief. The Queen says witnesses might be found at Nexton. The Fellowship asks the Queen what the royal treasure is. The Queen describes a bottle containing a certain liquid. Without it, she trails off, but the desperation in her voice suggests its loss could spell disaster for the kingdom. Usually, one would expect recompense for this sort of undertaking. You're quite a mercenary, but as demanding a reward would go against the tenets of the Ivory Order, you hold your tongue. The Queen, however, has already said she will reward the Fellowship with whatever they desire. It seems the royal treasure is just that important. Pray tarry no longer here. I await news of your success. The Fellowship bows and takes their leave. We can waste no time finding the treasure. Winifred strides toward town. Wait, cries Berwin, blocking Winifred's path. A monster. You dare stand in our way? Edwin scowls at the foul creature. It lunges at the Fellowship. Thank you. Winifred heaves a disgruntled sigh as she smooths her rumpled garb. Showing no signs of weariness from battle, Berwin silently wipes the monster's ichor from his weapon. Hedwin inspects the remains of their foe. The queen spoke true, he mutters, his face masked in contemplation. Winifred gives a grim nod at his words. Mayhap the treasure's theft and the monster's behavior are connected somehow. First things first, the Fellowship needs to gather more information. To Nixton, they set their sights. Welcome to Nixton, hails a man. The man doesn't respond to any question except to parrot back his original greeting. Fellowship asks if he's heard anything about the theft of the royal treasure. The man's eyes widen. He leans close to Winifred and whispers something in her ear. Welcome to Nixton. Too scared to leave town with all those monsters out there, the woman sighs. The man helpfully advises you take the opportunity to purchase equipment and curatives while you are in town. How may I help you? The proprietor inquires. Will that be all? The proprietor asks. A woman sits hunched over by the side of the road. Upon catching sight of the fellowship, she calls out for their aid. She's sprained her ankle and needs you to take her to the nearby apothecary. Winifred rushes to her and helps her up. Berwin lifts the woman onto his back, and the fellowship sets out in search of an apothecary. You arrive at the apothecary. After taking a curative, the woman begins hopping up and down. Nothing holds a candle to Ivory Order medicine, she beams. She turns to the fellowship, her eyes widening in surprise. You three. It seems she's only now realized the fellowship are disciples of the Ivory Order. The woman takes each of their hands in turn, thanking them for their service. The Ivory Order is famous for providing medical supplies throughout the realm, and indeed the wider world. Every smile the Order brings to someone's face makes Winifred proud to be a disciple. Thank you. The man claims he saw a suspicious someone leaving the castle grounds carrying what looked to be a medicine bottle. He didn't get a good look at their face, but says they were nothing but skin and bone. The fellowship thanks the man for the useful information. The woman begs the fellowship for their autographs. She seems to greatly admire the order. I know there's nothing to worry about with disciples of the order here, she says, relief flooding her features. Upon asking, the woman says she was attacked by a monster outside of town. A strange creature, she says, nothing but bones, and it clutched a bottle of medicine as if its life depended on it. Nothing holds a candle to ivory order medicine, proclaims the woman, swigging this curative and that. How may I help you? The proprietress inquires. Will that be all? The proprietress asks. You make your way to the inn, where you're greeted with a hearty hello by the owner. You're from the Ivory Order, aren't you? Thanks to a royal decree, you're allowed to stay the night for free, and you're not about to refuse such hospitality. The party leaves the inn feeling rested. Apparently, there's a monster lurking around the outskirts of town stealing medicine, and only medicine. Rumors claim the monster fled to the west. Thanks to the information gleaned from the townsfolk, the fellowship is all but certain of who has stolen the royal treasure. The first clue was the queen's description of the treasure, a small bottle containing a certain liquid. Then there's the bony figure seen fleeing town, the skeletal monster clutching the bottle of medicine, and the monster that fled west. From all that information, the Fellowship distills the thief's true identity. Realization strikes Winifred. I know who our thief is. The monster made of bones, Hedwyn interjects. The one that fled west. Berwyn nods in agreement, as if to say, another sage pronouncement from the great and wise Hedwyn. Winifred clears her throat, proclaims that the Fellowship shall head west, out of town, and walks off. An innocent-looking young boy accosts the Fellowship. Want to play a game with me? He asks expectantly. In this parlor, you can play cards. The child rambles on, wheedling you. I'll give you this if you play with me. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thanks for playing, the boy squeals. He hands over the medicine bottle as promised.
Thank you.
fight. Bizarre rock appeared. It seems primed to explode. The bizarre rock transformed into a fear rock. The only way out of this fight is through it. Don't hold back. Thank you. fellowship moves westward, only to be unnerved by the sight of a human figure moving through the trees. The presence of large packs suggests a traveler. I beg your pardon, but did you catch sight of a monster fleeing west? Winifred inquires. He gives her a puzzled look. There's nothing out there but the sea, he says. That and a cave full of monsters on the opposite shore. I suspect you might find your quarry there. The fellowship exchange glances and nod as if to say, then that is where we shall go. Alas, they will need a boat to cross the sea. The traveler hoists his packs, suggests the fellowship speak to the fishermen on the western shore, and takes his leave. The enemy. Fight. Thank you. The fellowship comes upon an anchored ship. Close by, a fisherman of exquisite physique pulls a net out of the water, his muscles rippling. This is no time for lustful reverie. Winifred races to his side and asks that he give the fellowship safe passage aboard the ship. That vessel is cursed, the fisherman mutters, trembling. Night after night, it leaves port without a soul aboard, headed I know not where. Come morning, it is once again anchored here. This, to the fisherman's mind, is the result of a curse. His head drops into his hands. With but a single dispeller, I am certain I could lift it and sail away. Winifred hands the despairing fisherman a dispeller and asks again for safe passage to the cave beyond the sea. The fisherman snatches up the concoction, so delighted that his pectoral muscles begin twitching. The fellowship politely ignores this fact. He opens the bottle and proceeds to douse the ship. Here to stay the night? The innkeeper asks, the moment you set foot in the inn. Thank you.